Hi, let's see the microcontroller block diagram today. So this is your 8051 basic microcontroller block diagram. So generally microcontrollers have its own block diagram, and the importance of block diagram is very clear. You need to understand what are the features supported by this specific microcontroller. So these blocks are not fixed even from 8051, from different manufacturers. Suppose you are working with some Philips, you may find some differences compared to your Atmel. Again, you are working with some other microcontroller like Motorola, you may find some differences between Philips and Motorola. Okay, but this is the standard microcontroller or basic microcontroller which come up with the basic features along with one CPU and connected with the different blocks. There are two different types of memories from microcontroller: RAM and ROM memory. And the next block is I/O ports, and other two blocks are timers, counters, and interrupts and serial port. See what they said, this is a basic and standard microcontroller. Every manufacturer has to follow these standards. Everyone is extended with new features whenever you are working with some Philips. If you are working with some Motorola, you may find somehow differences other than these six standard blocks. Okay, so this CPU is connected with these all these individual blocks: RAM, ROM, I/O ports, timers, counters, interrupts and serial port. So you need to understand the importance of each block from these microcontrollers. So whenever you are trying to understand the importance of each block from microcontrollers, it is easy to use so and so feature in a specific applications. Suppose you are trying to connect with some analog sensors, then you need to search for ADC block from the microcontroller. If you are trying to connect with any digital sensors or any peripherals, you need to deal with these I/O ports. Okay, so if you are looking for some communication based applications, you need to depend on the serial port and the memories which are help us to store our data or program. And this entire thing which is processed by your CPU unit. So whenever you are trying to know the importance of each block, so you need to focus on processor first. The processor means your central processing unit. It is a processor. As per yesterday conversation, you already knows every microcontroller is integrated with processor and two memories which are RAM and ROM and I/O ports and with some extended features. So this is a simple block diagram, which is a basic microcontroller block diagram, you can understand. So from processor, there are three important points you need to focus. One is bit capacity, and second point is architecture, and third point is registers. So every processor has its own individual bit capacity, individual architecture, and they are supporting some registers to store your data temporarily. So always your processor has its own bit capacity. Based on the bit capacity of your CPU, you are going to decide your controller bit capacities. How can you say that 8051 is an 8-bit microcontroller? So based on the processor, what they used internally as a CPU. Even for LPC families, how we are knowing that LPC2148 is an 32-bit microcontroller? So they are using ARM7, is a 32-bit processor, they are using it as a CPU. So like this, based on the processor bit capacity, you are going to decide your controller bit capacities. For your 8051, the bit capacity is 8-bit. And what is meant by architecture? See, the processor which is connected with all these blocks with the help of two standard buses. One is address bus and data bus. So whenever you are trying to know this address bus and data bus, so how can you define your address? So technically, address is what? The name of the peripheral or name of the location. So name of the location is defined as address, and who will carry your address from CPU to peripheral? Address bus. And this address bus has its own capacity. It may be 8-bit, or it may be 16-bit, or it may be 32-bit. It will change according to your devices. So you should know the clear information about processor, its bit capacity and architecture. And from architecture point of view, you need to focus on this address bus size and data bus size. And the data is technically defined as value of the location or information in the location, which is defined as data. And who will carry your information between CPU and peripheral? Data bus. Bus means it's a carrier between CPU and peripheral. So these two buses have their own sizes, and your microcontroller, which is supporting different memories for data storage and different memories for program storage. If you are finding these two things as different, then the processor architecture is Harvard architecture. And you are finding same memory for program storage and same memory for data storage, which is Van Neumann architecture. So these two buses are helping us. One bus which is helping us to carry the address, and address bus is always unidirectional, which is from CPU to peripheral. And data bus you are going to mention as bidirectional. So because you need to carry the information between peripheral and CPU, and CPU to peripheral. So this is how you are representing your buses. And if these two buses sizes are different, then the architecture is Harvard, and buses sizes are same, that architecture is Van Neumann. So this is the individual information about processor. And the third point is registers. So every processor will come up with some list of registers like A, B, C, D. This I think you studied even in basic processors, 8085, 8086. Even from microcontroller also, which is CPU is supporting some list of registers. Maybe names are different, but every processor will support some list of registers to store the data. Okay, so A, B, R0, R1, these are the registers of 8051 processor. But no need to by heart anything, but you should understand the processors are supporting some list of registers to store the data. So these three points are very important about every processor. Maybe the processor is a part of controller, or processor is an individual processor. So its bit capacity, its architecture, and its registers. Then the next block, which is the RAM. So RAM stands for random access memory. So this memory again used for store data temporarily. So the same definition you are giving for registers also, but registers, then what is the difference between register and RAM memory? Registers are also used to store the data temporarily, and RAM memory is also used to store data temporarily. The difference is very clear. The registers from CPU don't have space to store your data. Again, if you are using register name in programs, they may occupy memory from RAM only. Which means indirectly, all registers from CPU which are going to use RAM memory locations to store the data. Then what is the use of giving registers from processors? So registers which are easy to access as a beginner, whenever you started learning microprocessors and microcontrollers, so it is very difficult to learn memory things and remembering addresses. This is all about difficulty. See, writing instruction move A comma some value, move B comma some value is very simple than moving the value into memory and moving the value into next location of RAM memory like this. Okay, but anyway, registers are very limited. They are giving almost at least from 2 to 8 registers. If your input values are more than 8, you need to depend on memory only. So even though you are using any register in programs, what means finally they are going to use RAM memory locations. All registers are the dummy names of memory locations. Then the RAM memory, which is called as data memory also in microcontrollers, especially even in embedded C programming, you are using a specific keyword data before data type. So if you are mentioning the data type data with a keyword, it means it is clearly showing that you are trying to save your data into RAM memory. Then the second type of memory is ROM. The ROM memory abbreviation is read-only memory. So this memory is allowed to store data permanently, and this memory, which is called as core memory in microcontrollers or program memory. So you are giving the standard name in microcontrollers terminology, which is core memory. So if you are keeping core before data type, this keyword allows to save data into ROM memory, not in RAM. So this is the thing you need to understand, the differences between two types of memories: one memory for data storage and the second memory for program storage. Okay. So I'm just saying the importance of each block from this device. And the next section is I/O ports. So the name itself, input output ports. So these input output ports are helping us to connect your peripherals. Peripherals means like sensors, keypads, switches, displays, motors, relays, whatever you want you can connect. You need to learn this I/O ports programming. Okay. Then what is your timers and counters from microcontroller? So timers and counters, again the timers importance is very clear. The timers are used to generate accurate time delays. Whenever you are looking to do time related operations from the applications, suppose I just want to turn on my load for every 5 minutes or 2 minutes, if you want to change the operation according to your time relation, then you can use this timers block from the microcontroller. In what way your counters are helping? So counters are used to count your external pulses or external objects. Suppose from your experiment, if you have any counter related operations, then you need to program this counters block. Then the interrupts. So interrupts, general meaning is very clear. Interrupt is a disturbance. But they added as a feature in microcontrollers because of one reason: it allows to break the main program execution and divert it to execute high priority tasks from your application. Because as a device, you cannot go for important tasks in the program. Okay, so your regular programming execution process is from top to bottom. So you cannot go, or you cannot set any priority in the specific block of your program. But if you are expecting any priority part from your application, you can keep it aside and write it as the ISR, which is name is interrupt service routine. So how to execute these interrupt service routines? Just by generating these interrupts to the microcontroller. If any part of your application is priority related, you can use this block from the controller. And the last block is serial port. The serial port, which is helping us to communicate with the external modules. The difference between serial port and I/O port is very clear. I/O ports are allowing to connect direct devices, and serial ports are allowing to connect your external devices through protocol. So without learning protocol, you cannot do data transmission between two devices, which means microcontroller and external device. So your communication ports, which are always link up with your protocols. So as a basic microcontroller, they are providing UART protocol or I2C protocol or SPI protocol or CAN protocol or USB protocol. Depends on type of applications, you need to check the protocol support from the controllers. So these blocks are extended in next generation microcontrollers, or even from 8051. If you are finding Philips 8051 microcontroller, it is extended with some ADC block. And don't think that all 8051 microcontrollers have same block diagram. No. So this block diagram is a standard which is measured with only 6 features, but if you are working with different manufacturers, the block diagram is going to change according to the manufacturer features. Even you may find some cost differences within your 8051 microcontrollers. Some protocols are also extended with the new manufacturers like Motorola. Even from Atmel 8051, I think don't have any the same features which is provided. But if you are working with any other manufacturers, please take care of your next extended blocks. So whenever you are finding a new block in a microcontroller, which means it is an added advantage for your applications. So any block which is available on microcontroller, it is so better for us to implement new kind of applications. So if I have ADC, yes, I can connect analog sensors to this device directly, because which is supporting analog to digital conversion. And if it is supporting on-chip I2C to me, I can connect EEPROM chips or RTCs or port expanders. Like this, I can deal with different devices. Okay, if any feature is available on the controller, then your applications or you can implement more applications with a low cost device. So always you should focus on the microcontroller block diagram. The block diagram is clears us what are the types of memories are available and what are the blocks are available and what is the importance of each block, that you need to clear from block diagram point of view. And the quantities also, you may find some differences. Suppose Philips manufacturer is providing some 1 kilobytes of RAM memory, but Atmel may provide only 128 bytes with respect to RAM. And if you are finding 4 kilobytes of ROM memory in Atmel controller, maybe from Philips you may find 8 kilobytes. This is how you need to know the importance of blocks from the device and the individual quantities. The quantities is also differed from manufacturer to manufacturer if you are not finding any differences with respect to blocks. This is a simple block diagram from microcontroller. So don't by heart any block diagram from microcontrollers. You should understand the purpose of each block from controllers. Thank you.